Good evening, viewers and aspirants. We have a small announcement for you. Shankar IAS Academy is going to start a new exclusive batch under the Prefit program. This new batch will start from 22nd March 2021. The new batch is because of the numerous requests received by us after the launch of first Prefit batch, which started from February 15th of 2021. This batch 1 will conclude by 16th May 2021. Now, with respect to the new batch, Academy is conducting free entrance exam on 14th March 2021, that is on coming Sunday. The syllabus for this entrance exam will be the UPSC Civil Services Prelim syllabus for General Studies and CSAT. And it is a free entrance exam, but registration is mandatory. Students who secure top 100 ranks in the entrance exam will be eligible for subsidized fee structure of rupees 800 plus GST per month. For other students, that is for students who find it challenging to come in top 100 ranks, and for direct admissions, the fee structure will be 1600 plus GST per month. And there is one important modification in this new batch, which is the availability of longer daily test window. That is, in this batch, students can take daily tests in the 4-hour time frame from 7 a.m. to 11 a.m. Numerous working professionals who are aspirants have requested for such extended window. Therefore, to accommodate varied circumstances of the aspirants in taking daily tests, this extended time window is provided under the new batch. The links for the detailed brochure of this new batch, the plan summary and schedule are available in the description box and in comment section. With this, let us move on to the Hindi news analysis for the date 11th March 2021. The list of news articles chosen for today's analysis along with the page numbers of different editions of Hindi newspaper is given here for your reference. Now let us start our first discussion with this op-ed article, which focuses on a type of diabetes, which is the gestational diabetes. So in this discussion, let us see about diabetes, gestational diabetes, then India's disease burden with respect to diabetes, and important points from the op-ed article. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. Note that diabetes is the common name we know, but medically it is called as diabetes mellitus, or in short, DM. Basically, diabetes is a chronic health condition, that is a long-lasting health condition that affects how our body turns food into energy. So it is a metabolic disorder. In this, a person has a high blood glucose level or high blood sugar level. This happens either due to inadequate insulin production or also because the body cells do not respond properly to insulin, or even maybe due to both of these reasons. That is, diabetes mellitus occurs either when the pancreas does not produce enough insulin or when the body cannot effectively use the insulin which is produced by pancreas. Here, insulin is nothing but a hormone that regulates blood sugar. Now, because of these two reasons or factors, or because of the combination of these two factors, the blood glucose levels becomes very high, and this condition of high blood glucose or blood sugar is called as hyperglycemia. And this is a common effect of uncontrolled diabetes, and over time it leads to serious damage to many of the body systems, especially the nerves and blood cells. See, what happens is most of the food we eat is broken down into sugar or glucose, and it is released into our bloodstream. So whenever the blood sugar goes up, it signals our pancreas to release insulin. So here, insulin acts like a key to let the blood sugar into our body's cells for use as energy. So if someone has diabetes, then their body either does not make enough insulin so that it can work as a key, or they cannot use the insulin which the pancreas makes like it actually should. So now what happens is too much blood sugar stays in the bloodstream, and over time, this too much blood can cause serious health problems such as heart disease, vision loss, and kidney disease also. But being a serious health problem, even yet there isn't any cure for diabetes. It can only be controlled. So certain treatments are available to keep the blood sugar levels in check. Treatment of diabetes involves diet and physical activity along with the lowering of blood glucose and lowering the levels of other known risk factors that damages the blood vessels. So a precautionary measure to avoid diabetes normally includes losing weight, eating healthy food, and also being active. So what about the disease burden caused by diabetes? According to WHO, in 2014 itself, about 422 million people, that is 42.2 crore people worldwide, had diabetes. And majority of them were living in low-income countries and middle-income countries such as India, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Philippines, and Indonesia. Apart from this, diabetes is also directly attributed to around 1.6 million deaths each year. Also, both the number of cases and the prevalence of diabetes have been steadily increasing over the past few decades. And according to recent WHO reports, deaths from diabetes increased by 70% globally between the period 2000 and 2019. This report also notes that there is an 80% rise in deaths due to diabetes among males. So what about India? India is among the top 10 countries in the world, and India stands second with 69.2 million people with diabetes. That is 6.92 crore people have diabetes. So that means for people living with diabetes, access to affordable treatment, including insulin, is critical for their survival. Here you should also note that as part of global non-communicable disease targets that provide a vision for progress by 2025, WHO has a globally agreed target to halt the rise in diabetes and obesity by the year 2025. But today, our focus is on a type of diabetes, which is gestational diabetes. See, there are three main types of diabetes. The first one is type 1 diabetes. It is thought to be caused by an autoimmune reaction. That is, the body attacks itself by mistake. And this autoimmune reaction stops our body from making insulin. So, type 1 diabetes is caused due to body's malfunction to produce insulin in the body, and it requires the person to inject insulin. Then there is type 2 diabetes. In this type, our body doesn't use insulin well and it can't keep the blood sugar at normal levels. And this is due to insulin resistance, which is a condition in which cells fail to use insulin properly. And about 90 to 95% of people with diabetes have this type 2 diabetes only. And then comes the third type, which is the gestational diabetes. See, gestation is nothing but the time between conception and childbirth. That is, the time between getting pregnant and childbirth. And in this gestation period, a fetus grows and develops in the womb of the mother. So this gestational diabetes occurs during pregnancy. It is the impaired glucose tolerance with onset or first recognition during pregnancy. That is, it develops in pregnant women who have never had diabetes. The pregnant women without previous diagnosis of diabetes develop a high blood glucose level under this gestational diabetes. So this gestational diabetes is hyperglycemia with blood glucose values above normal but below those diagnostics of diabetes. That is why author calls pregnancy as a diabetogenic stress. Diabetogenic means the one that produces a persistent elevation in blood glucose concentration. But here also note that this gestational diabetes usually goes away after the baby is born. But there are major issues with this gestational diabetes, which is first, it may lead to type 2 diabetes mellitus. And second, women with gestational diabetes are at high or increased risk of complications during pregnancy and also at delivery. Additionally, these women and possibly their children are also at increased risk of type 2 diabetes in the future. The baby could be also at higher risk for other health problems. And the mother could also have these high risk health problems. Now, all these conditions or the high risk health problems contribute to high maternal morbidity and mortality and newborn morbidity and mortality. So, it ultimately leads to high maternal mortality rate and child mortality rate. So, in this regard only, author provides certain facts related to gestational diabetes. First is women of Indian origin, particularly South Asian origin, are considered to be at highest risk of gestational diabetes. According to the estimation by International Diabetes Federation, up to 25% of pregnancies in South Asia itself may be affected by hyperglycemia in pregnancy. And particularly in India, gestational diabetes is present in 10% of pregnancies in rural areas and it is present in 30% of pregnancies in urban areas. So in total, approximately 2.7 crore to 3 crore pregnancies each year in India is affected by gestational diabetes. See, even though it is this much common, awareness regarding gestational diabetes is very less. Author even criticizes that there is also low awareness and capacity within the health system itself regarding gestational diabetes. That is, there is lack of capacity for testing and providing care when it comes to gestational diabetes. So this is the scenario despite the fact that there is availability of national guidelines in this regard and there is also diagnostic and management guidelines for gestational diabetes. And these are all provided by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare of Government of India. So to increase awareness or to tackle this lack of awareness, author provides a suggestion. This suggestion is based on the recommendation of various organizations such as Diabetes Study Group of India, the South Asia Initiative for Diabetes in Pregnancy, etc. All these organizations have recommended to observe a National Gestational Diabetes Awareness Day, and this is to be observed on March 10th. This day is chosen as it is the birthday of Dr. V. Sheshayya, who has provided recognizable service and contribution to the field of diabetes and pregnancy for more than 40 years. So they believe that if one day is observed for the awareness of gestational diabetes, then people will be more aware of it and more testing facilities will be developed and provided and appropriate care will be taken. This will not only enhance the awareness about gestational diabetes, but it will also increase the capacity for testing and providing care. So these are some of the points that you should know with respect to diabetes and gestational diabetes. Now let's move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is based on this news article, which talks about a report of the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Education. In a significant development, this standing committee has recommended that all government schools may start providing free breakfast in the coming academic year. And this will be a part of an expansion of the midday meal scheme as envisaged by the National Education Policy. According to the article, the School Education Department under the Ministry of Education had proposed two new components to the midday meal scheme during 2021-22, and these two components are: first one is expanding the coverage of the scheme, that is, they want to expand the scheme from the current class of 1 to 8 students to include pre-primary students also, and the second component is the provision of breakfast. But the issue is, this much needed initiative is unlikely to happen in the near future as there is a severe fund crunch in the ministry. So in this context, let us discuss about the midday meal scheme. See, the midday meal scheme in schools has a long history in India. First, it was started in 1920 by the government of Madras Presidency. Madras Presidency was then ruled by the Justice Party. And this midday meal scheme was the idea of P. Thyagaraja Chetty, who was the then president of Justice Party. Now, based on his idea, the government implemented the midday meal scheme in a corporation school in Chennai. And under this scheme, breakfast was provided. So based on this, more students started joining the school, but British government at that time discontinued the scheme because of this. However, later in 1925, the scheme was re-implemented to cover more schools. Then in the year 1956, the then Chief Minister of Tamil Nadu, K. Kamarajar, he introduced the midday meal scheme for school children throughout the state for the first time. So initially, a midday meal program was introduced for disadvantaged children in Madras Municipal Corporation only. And slowly, this idea started spreading to other states. And by the mid-1980s, three states, namely Gujarat, Kerala and Tamil Nadu, and even the UT of Pondicherry, had universalized a cooked midday meal program. And they started these programs with their own resources for the children studying at the primary stage. Then later in 1990-91, the number of states implementing this program with their own resources on a universal scale or a large scale had increased to 12. That is, 12 states started to implement this. So in the year 1995, a centrally sponsored scheme was launched by the government, which is the National Program of Nutritional Support to Primary Education. The objective of this scheme was to enhance the enrollment, retention and attendance and simultaneously improve the nutritional levels among children. So under this scheme, the central assistance of free supply of food grains at 100 grams per child per school day was provided. Then subsidy for the transportation of food grains was also provided. Then in the year 2004, the scheme was revised to provide cooked midday meal scheme with 300 calories and 8 to 12 grams of protein to all children studying in class 1 to 5 in government schools and government aided schools. At this time, the scheme also provided central assistance for cooking cost at rupees 1 per child per school day, and it also increased the transport subsidy. Then later in the year 2007, the scheme was further revised to cover children in upper primary, that is, children in classes 6 to 8. Then from the year 2008-09, the program covers all children studying in government schools, local body schools and government-aided primary and upper primary schools, and even in the madrasas supported in the Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan. So here the calorific value of a midday meal at upper primary stage has been fixed at a minimum of 700 calories and 20 grams of protein by providing 150 grams of food grains per child per school day. Here the food grains include rice or wheat. So we can say that the proper implementation of a midday meal scheme has several advantages. First, it improves nutritional status of children. Second, it also encourages poor children belonging to the disadvantaged sections of our country to attend school more regularly. And this will ultimately lead to increase in literacy rate. So these are some of the points that you should know about midday meal scheme and its development. Now let's move on to the next discussion. This discussion is based on this editorial article and this article which appeared in yesterday's newspaper. Both of these articles deal with Supreme Court's order with reference to creating a national environment regulator. This order is the judgment of Supreme Court, which was made in July 2011 in a case law called as Lafarge Umiam Mining Private Limited versus Union of India. This case law is being commonly known as the Lafarge Mining case. So in this analysis, we will discuss in brief about Lafarge Mining case, important points or observations from the judgment. Then we'll also see the status of implementation of the verdict and then other relevant points discussed by the author in the editorial. See, Lafarge Surma Cements Limited is a company incorporated under the laws of Bangladesh. It has set up a cement manufacturing project at Chatok in Bangladesh. For this purpose, it had a captive limestone mine of 100 acres. Now, this mine is located in the Nong Thrai region of East Khasi Hills district in Meghalaya. The mine is leased out in favor of Lafarge Umium Mining Private Limited. This private limited company is a wholly owned subsidiary of Lafarge Surma Cement Limited, and it is also an incorporated company under the Indian Companies Act of 1956. Now, the entire produce of the mine is used for the production of cement at the manufacturing plant in Chatok, Bangladesh, and this is based on the agreement or arrangement between the Government of India and Government of Bangladesh. So, the Lafarge, which is mentioned in the news articles, is this company only. Now, here Umium refers to a river valley in Meghalaya. Now, this river valley is associated because the leased area of Lafarge Umium Mining Private Limited lies on the west side of Umium River Valley. So, what is the case? This case pertains to a series of processes followed by the company in relation to obtaining environmental clearances and site clearances. And this case is connected with various communications which the company had with Union Ministry of Environment, the state government, and with the local authorities. And all these are related to processes that happened in the late 1990s and in the first decade of 21st century. At that time, till 2006, the EIA notification, that is Environment Impact Assessment Notification, which was dated January 1994, was in operation. Now, this notification was slightly amended by the April 1997 notification. So, here the company made an application in September 1997 for granting environmental clearance for limestone mining project at Nong Thrai in the East Khasi Hills district in Meghalaya. Now, the application was returned by Ministry of Environment and Forest as the application did not follow the procedure that was modified by the 1997 April amendment. So, mainly the case pertains to the alleged dishonest disclosure of facts while applying for clearances. The project proponents had allegedly hidden that some parts of the site includes forest for which the additional clearance is required under the Forest Conservation Act of 1980. This detail was hidden by the company. In addition to this, some conditions imposed by the government were also not followed by the proponent. So that is why the case was filed, and in relation to this case only, the judgment was given by Supreme Court. And in this judgment, Supreme Court has given some guidelines to the Union Government. Here the guidelines are important for our examination, but the technical details of the case is not important. So let us see the important guidelines given by the court. The first guideline is that the principles or guidelines mentioned in the National Forest Policy of 1988 should be read as part of the provisions of Environment Protection Act of 1986, which is read together with the Forest Conservation Act of 1980. Here the court observed that this direction is required to be given because there is no machinery established for the implementation of the National Forest Policy of 1988, read with Forest Conservation Act of 1980. The court further observed that Section 3 of the Environment Protection Act of 1986 confers a power coupled with duty on the central government. So, this power coupled with duty is nothing but to appoint an appropriate authority, preferably in the form of a regulator, and this regulator should be appointed at the state level and at the central level for ensuring implementation of the National Forest Policy of 1988. And finally, the Apex Court also stated that under Section 3, Clause 3 of the Environment Protection Act of 1986, the central government should appoint a national regulator, and this national regulator is for appraising projects, for enforcing environmental conditions for approvals, and also to impose penalties on the polluters. So mainly the regulator, among other functions, will deal with the regulation related to environmental clearances, and broadly it was envisaged to deal with enforcement of environmental laws, rules and regulations. So these are the three important guidelines given by the court. Some other important guidelines are given here for your reference. So now, why we are talking about this order now? See, this order was delivered by court in July 2011. So it is more than 9 years, but till now the central government has not constituted the National Environment Regulator as directed by the Supreme Court. So the matter is now before the Supreme Court through a public interest litigation which had raised the issue of lack of credibility in the environment impact assessment process. Now, when Supreme Court asked why National Environment Regulator is not yet constituted, the center has responded that it was just a guideline given by the Supreme Court, so it may not be binding on the central government. So here, some environmental rights defenders say that the central government since 2011 have been focusing more on development and not on sustainable development. See, here difference is that development is at the cost of environment. But sustainable development is by balancing the needs of the present and the future and by properly giving required weight to environment in the decision-making process. So, environmental rights defenders comment that since the successive governments since 2011 are more focused on ease of doing business, they have not yet constituted this regulator as ordered by Supreme Court. See, here you may think that we already have a National Green Tribunal. Then why we need a regulator? It is because a regulator is for enforcement, but a tribunal or a court is for adjudication when a given situation is brought to the notice of such tribunal. So this is the issue going on with reference to the Lafarge mining case and about the National Environmental Regulator. So in this regard, the author of this editorial has stated that even though a National Environmental Regulator is established, for the regulator to regulate properly, the central government must do three things. First one is that the government should recognize its limits to extractive growth. Here, extractive growth refers to the growth that is attained by extensive extraction of natural resources without provision for their renewal. Then the second thing that has to be done by central government is that it should respect the body, that is the National Environmental Regulator, as a neutral and independent body. And thirdly, government must be committed to preserve the integrity of the environment. So before establishing the National Environmental Regulator, author has asked the government to keep these three points in mind. So these are some of the points that you should know about the recent issue regarding Lafarge mining case and the National Environmental Regulator. Now let us move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is based on this news article, which talks about a new fund approved by the Union Cabinet, chaired by the Prime Minister. The Union Cabinet has approved the Pradhan Mantri Swasthya Suraksha Nidhi. Here, Swasthya Suraksha Nidhi means Health Protection Fund. This fund will be a single non-lapsable reserve fund for health. See, non-lapsable means if the fund amount is unspent from the capital budget of the ministry, then it will not lapse and it will continue in the next fiscal year also. And this Pradhan Mantri Swasthya Suraksha Nidhi will be from the proceeds of health and education cess that is levied under Section 136B of Finance Act of 2007. That is, the proceeds of share of health in the health and education cess will be credited into this fund, and the accruals into this fund will be utilized for the flagship schemes of Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, such as Ayushman Bharat Pradhan Mantri Jan Arogya Yojana, then Ayushman Bharat Health and Wellness Centers, then for National Health Mission, then for Pradhan Mantri Swasthya Suraksha Yojana, and it will be also used for any future programs or schemes of the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. So, the administration and maintenance of this fund is entrusted to the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. Now, its major benefit is that this fund will enable enhanced access to universal and affordable health care through availability of earmarked resources, at the same time ensuring that the amount does not lapse at the end of the financial year. So, that is all about this Pradhan Mantri Swasthya Suraksha Nidhi. Now let's move to the next discussion. Now this next news article mentions about the floating solar power plant. That is, India's biggest floating solar power plant till date is set to be commissioned by May to June of this year. This is the biggest floating solar power plant based on its generation capacity. And this is a 100 megawatt plant which is being developed by NTPC Limited across 450 acres of water surface area in a reservoir which is a part of NTPC's thermal plant in Telangana. And this is how a floating solar power plant looks like. And these floating solar power plants are an opportunity to generate power with low cost because land acquisition of at least 5 acres per megawatt of capacity involves huge fixed cost. But since there are large number of major reservoirs in the southern region, including Telangana, using the floating solar method is a huge opportunity to go for renewable energy. So in this regard, let us discuss in detail about the solar energy. The syllabus that is relevant to this discussion is given here for your reference. See, solar energy is nothing but the energy obtained from sun. It is simply the light and heat that comes from the sun. See, the amount of sunlight that strikes the Earth's surface in an hour and a half is enough to handle entire world's energy consumption for full year. But we are not harnessing this energy to its full potential. So that is why these kinds of floating solar power plants, which does not require land, is a benefit in this regard. Now, how can we harness this sun's energy? It can be harnessed in a few different ways. First, by using photovoltaic cells. These are also called as solar cells. They convert sunlight into electricity. Then we can also use the solar thermal technology. In this, heat from the sun is used to make hot water or steam. Then there is passive solar heating also, which is nothing but letting the sun shine through windows to heat the inside of a building. And today our focus will be on photovoltaic cells, because this thermal plant in Telangana is using photovoltaic cells only. So let us see how it works. See, when light shines on a photovoltaic cell, or in short PV cell, that light may be reflected or absorbed, or it can also pass right through the cell. Now this PV cell is composed of semiconductor material, and there are different kinds of semiconductor materials that can be used in PV cells. Now when the semiconductor is exposed to light, it absorbs the light's energy and then it transfers it to negatively charged particles in the material called as electrons. This extra energy allows the electrons to flow through the material as an electrical current. So in this representation you can see what is happening inside a photovoltaic cell. So what is the efficiency of a PV cell? It is simply the amount of electrical power coming out of the cell compared to the energy from the light shining on it. Now the amount of electricity produced from PV cells depends on characteristics such as the intensity and wavelengths of the light available and even the multiple performance attributes of the cell. So this is where the semiconductor becomes an important part of PV cell, because it helps to increase the efficiency of the PV cell. And know that silicon is by far the most common semiconductor material used in solar cells. It represents approximately 95% of the modules that are sold today. It is also the second most abundant material on earth after oxygen, and it is the most common semiconductor used in computer chips. So here what they do is, crystalline silicon cells are made of silicon atoms. They are connected to one another to form a crystal lattice or grid. This grid provides an organized structure that makes conversion of light into electricity more efficient. And that is why solar cells made out of silicon currently provide a combination of high efficiency, low cost and long lifetime. Long lifetime because modules that are made of silicon are expected to last for 25 years or more. And even after this long period of usage, they still produce more than 80% of their original power. So you should remember, PV cell is related to solar energy and silicon helps to increase its efficiency. So what does India stand on solar energy? See, since solar energy is a renewable energy, India has set a target of installing 175 gigawatt of renewable energy capacity by the year 2022. This you all know. Now in this 175 gigawatts, there is 100 gigawatt from solar energy, then 60 gigawatt from wind energy, and then 10 gigawatt from biopower, and also 5 gigawatt from small hydropower. In addition to this, recently our Prime Minister has also said that India would achieve the target of 450 gigawatt of renewable energy generation by the year 2030. So the 175 gigawatt target is for 2022. This has been increased to 450 gigawatt by the year 2030. So in this regard, India has made several initiatives. Let us see some of the initiatives with respect to solar energy. As you know, India is the leader of International Solar Alliance. This International Solar Alliance is a coalition of solar resource rich countries. And then we also have the Jawaharlal Nehru National Solar Mission, or simply the National Solar Mission. Then we have the scheme of PM Kusum scheme, which is Kisan Urja Suraksha Evam Uthan Mahabhyan scheme. Then we have the development of solar parks scheme, then grid connected solar rooftop scheme, and then small solar power plant scheme, etc. So government is initiating many such schemes for encouraging the installment of solar renewable energy. So these are some of the points that you should know about solar energy. Now let's move on to the next discussion. Our next discussion is based on this news article, which talks about a program called as Upsurge. This program will happen in collaboration with the Australian government. And note that this program is an initiative of V-Hub. So in this context, let us know about V-Hub and its Upsurge program. V-Hub stands for Women Entrepreneurs Hub. It is an initiative by the Telangana government. It was set up in 2018 and it has been registered under the Indian Companies Act of 2013. And remember that this V-Hub is India's first and only state-led incubator. So when you say incubator, it means a place, especially with support staff and equipment. And this place is made available at low rent to new small businesses. So this is the first and only state-led incubator of India. And its primary goal is to promote and foster women entrepreneurship through incubation, through government access, and through a collaborative system. So through incubation, V-Hub wants to empower women entrepreneurs from various sectors to start and scale up their businesses by providing support in funding, mentoring, strategy, and growth. It ensures that all Indian women entrepreneurs have got the access to technical support, financial support, governmental and policy support that are necessary to grow and sustain with the global market access. Now, in this regard, it has started an initiative called Upsurge. It is a 3-month pre-incubation program that focuses on inculcating the knowledge of entrepreneurship, and it aims to help the aspiring entrepreneurs to develop their business models. So it is a pre-incubator program wherein the entrepreneurial ideas are analyzed and reviewed for market growth so as to prevent the greater costs and failures of setting up a new company. And presently, WeHub is carrying out this program in partnership with the Australian Consulate General that is present at Chennai. This program will be happening for 12 weeks, and in that stipulated time, it will provide the required tools for entrepreneurs to translate their ideas into sustainable business models. So the aim of the program is to mitigate the drop-off rate from entrepreneurship by women, and it also aims to reduce the percentage of women entrepreneurs who are hesitating to enter entrepreneurship. So it is believed that this program will play a key role in providing different forms of assistance to amateur entrepreneurs in the idea development stages itself. So this is one of the measures taken to empower women. You should take note of these kinds of initiatives, which will be helpful for you in writing a mains answer. And remember that even though it is a state-led initiative, it is important because there were already questions in mains examinations which were focused particularly on state-led initiatives. So now let us move on to the next discussion. Now we have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. This question asks, forests is a subject matter enumerated in state list, concurrent list, union list, not mentioned in 7th schedule to the constitution. It is mentioned in the 7th schedule, so option D is incorrect. And note that forests as a subject was inserted by the Constitutional 42nd Amendment Act of 1976 into the list 3, that is the concurrent list. And these are the other subjects that were also inserted along with this. So the correct answer is option B, concurrent list. Now this next question asks, at present, it is the most common semiconductor material used in solar cells. It is the second most abundant material on earth and the most common semiconductor used in computer chips. The above paragraph best describes option A, germanium, option B, silicon, option C, gallium arsenide, option D, bismuth. And the correct answer is option B, silicon. We discussed this during the analysis. Now this next question is about midday meal scheme. The question asks, the midday meals in schools was introduced to address two of the pressing problems for majority of children in India, that were hunger and education. It was launched for the first time in India in option A, Bombay, option B, Bengal, option C, United Provinces, option D, Madras. And the correct answer is option D, Madras. As we saw, it was launched in the 1920s by the government of Madras Presidency based on the idea of P. Thyagaraya Chetty. So correct answer is option D. Now this next question is based on diabetes. First statement is, type 1 diabetes is more common than type 2 diabetes. Now this statement is incorrect because during discussion itself we saw that about 90-95% of people with diabetes have type 2 diabetes only, and only around 5-10 people have type 1 diabetes. So this statement is incorrect. It should be other way around. Now the second statement is, gestational diabetes occurs in diabetic women who are pregnant. Now this statement is also incorrect. You should read this statement very carefully. It states it occurs in diabetic women who are pregnant. But during discussion we saw that gestational diabetes occurs during pregnancy, but it develops in pregnant women who have never had diabetes. And we also saw that usually it goes away after the birth of the child. Now the third statement is, WHO has globally agreed target to halt the rise in diabetes by 2025. This statement is correct. And here the question asks for the incorrect statements. So the correct answer is option B, 1 and 2 only. Now this next question is a direct question. Among the following states, which is the only state to initiate a state-led incubator to develop and promote women entrepreneurship? And the given options are Maharashtra, Telangana, Kerala, Madhya Pradesh. And the correct answer is option B, Telangana. Now let us take one mains question. This is based on gestational diabetes and you have to comment on this statement. You have to answer this question in 150 words and you can post the answer in comment section. With this, we come to the end of today's Hindi news analysis. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share, and do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.